Hello and welcome everyone to the 46th official episode of Eunuch Corner Club. Today at the Corner Club, we have an awesome new friend I've made. His name is Spoon, hence the intro. We'll be getting to know him, hearing about his work here in a few minutes. I'm not going to play more than a couple of minutes of that song because we all know how the sniffer bots work here on the YouTubes. Speaking of YouTubes, I am broadcasting my Corner Club segment to YouTube, but Dragons of Discord, as well as other spicier streams and content, of course, will no longer appear on YouTube. That will be only on Odyssey. And speaking of Odyssey, you might ask yourself, well, yes, why are you not broadcasting to Odyssey today? Excuse me. Sorry, I had a big sneeze there. I've been very allergic to something this week with all the work I've done. The reason that we're not on Odyssey today is when I went to go live on Odyssey today, it's down. And I couldn't link the stream, and I couldn't make it start working. So I don't know what the issue is over on Odyssey. I've never had that problem before, but I have seen it go down before. So we're just going to roll with it and not have Odyssey today. Sorry for those of you that may wanted to watch over there. But we do, of course, have Entropy, DLive, Trovo active. So please engage on all of those platforms. Share the link out. I want people to know Spoon. He makes awesome content. He's a funny, smart guy. I'm trying to help him grow. We'll be meeting him soon. But first of all, I would like to thank the monthly supporters to this channel. You can support this channel monthly over on Subscribestar. It helps me out tremendously. I would like to thank Heidi Van Buskirk, Already Death, Joseph Landman, Deus Light, Orcus and Little Red, Delicus White, Healing, Violence's Life, and Sex Smits. They all support me monthly over on Subscribestar. And if you would like to ensure that I have the money that I need to focus on making good content, networking, bringing good guests together, and building fun comedy streams for Discordant Dragons, please consider supporting me monthly on Subscribestar. You can also support me via Cash App, PayPal, Entropy, excuse me, and I even have a mycelium wallet, and I have a physical address if you'd like to mail me stuff. Every few months, I do a video of all the goodies and supportive things people send me via mail. And at this moment, before we get rolling, I would like to thank Bo and Eric. And I'm not going to read your last names because they tell me your real last names connected to your account on PayPal. But Bo sent me $30 US, and he says, onward. He is a recent Israelite that has discovered me. Speaking of people that have recently discovered me, Eric sends me $75 US on PayPal. Thank you so much, friend. That's a great, huge donation. He says he discovered me through the American Zarathustra podcast that I did last night, that I premiered on my channel last night. He says he's really into my content and wants me to keep up the good work. Thank you very much. That big donation will definitely help me keep up the good work. Now, speaking of thanks, I'm very thankful for my next guest for being here today. Let's go ahead and bring him on and say howdy. And here he is. Hello, Mr. Spoon.
Good afternoon. Or morning, whatever it is by you guys.
It's early afternoon, just crossing 12 p.m. here in the Eastern time zone of Medicaid. And I know that how about you just take a moment and tell us about yourself? Tell me where you started, anything that won't dox you that you'd like to tell us about yourself. Tell us a little bit about who you are as a man, and then we'll get moving with who you are as a content creator.
Not much to say. South African, born and raised there, and moved to Europe at a young age of 11, which screwed my mind because I came from quite a conservative Christian family. And then going to Europe, which is not very Christian conservative, regardless of what the hell people have you believe, it's not. It's liberal as hell. And Ireland especially is not very Christian in its roots. It has this massive thing of, oh, look, there's a lot of Catholics. Yeah, no, they are progressive as holy bollocks. Trust me. And they roll over for government left, right, and center. There is no fighting the Irish. I don't care what anyone says. The Irish are not known for fighting spirits. They roll over and do whatever they're told. They're bitches.
It definitely seems in the recent years of me paying attention to things, I mean, not things, but paying attention to Dave Cullen has told me anything. There is not a lot of resistance in Ireland right now.
No, there isn't. But the fun thing of it is that if you choose to disobey, no one is going to check you on it because they have the sort of Englishy tradition of, ooh, I don't want to make a fuss. So if you decide to make a fuss, they're not going to say shit. So there is that.
What led you to being in Ireland, if you don't mind me asking?
Oh, my mother is in the medical field, and when she was like in her when was I? I was 11 years old. So I think when she, so early 30s, I imagine would have been for her, where she just said, we should go for a year. Actually, that was my father's idea. And then, and we're 20 years later, we're still here. So that's okay. how that goes.
Fair enough. So you started off in SA, but you've been in Ireland for the last couple decades then.
Yeah, but I would never consider myself Irish. By any means.
That's why I didn't call you an Irishman.
Yeah. No, it's fine, but people just ask me like, what do you identify as? That alone makes me want to punch him. I identify as where I'm from, which is South Africa, and I think I still, it's mainly a family thing, because you don't lose touch of your roots, and you still speak the language. And if I go home now and I speak Afrikaans with this weird accent, it's a bit weird, because my linguistic skills essentially didn't progress any further than an 11-year-old's, because you don't read Afrikaans books when you switch to an English country for the rest of your life. So that's a bit of a mixed bundle. But I spoke to my grandmother a while ago, because she's on the verge of turning 90. Well done. She will make 100 at this point. Yeah, she will make 100. I've no doubt about it. And
as long as she stays away from that vaccine.
Oh, yes. Oh, my goodness. Speaking of that, we actually spoke about that as well. And my grandmother was very happy. She just said, are you still South African? I said, yes, of course. I still watch rugby. I still support the Springboks. I still like Sunshine, and I still eat Biltong. Yes, I will always be a Springbok.
Based.
And she went, okay, that's good to hear. I didn't know my grandmother was like uber nationalist, so I'm happy about that. And
that
we spoke about the vaccine, and she just went, I don't trust that damn thing. And my mother is the same way, so I looked at my family and went, oh my God, all the baseness comes from the females, which is really weird. You'd think it'd be a guy thing. Nope, my family, all the baseness is from the Whammons. A very unusual trait in the family.
Well, we need based Whammonses too, of course.
Yeah, so, they're very pro-male, actually.
speaking of, give me a second, I have to, there we go. I'm trying to pop this open and it's being fussy. Give me a second. Come on. I don't know why. Yeah. Sometimes with the Restream, whenever I go to share a link, it's really slow. It makes me redo it. There it goes. Okay, it went through that time.
From Restream to Restringing.
This is Spoon's channel, and I found Spoon recently. His channel's excellent. And I'm going to share the link in all of the chat for everyone here. This is the link directly to Spoon's videos.
Yeah. I should have a video coming up later today about the California recall with Newsom.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah,
because there's some things going on right there that I found is a bit unusual, because now, as is the case with every GOP candidate pushing for power, we must slander them with social issues, because that's all the Democrats have, never policy.
Yeah.
And now it's Larry Elder held someone at gunpoint and they left a relationship. And in my head, I'm thinking, how does this keep sticking? It was the case with Clarence Thomas. It was the case with Kavanaugh. Now it's Elder. Like, you can see the pattern, and it just conveniently comes out as soon as there arise to prominence and political power. So, yeah, there comes a point where it's that boy who cried wolf kind of thing doesn't work anymore. Now it's a bitch who cried for money.
So new. you've made a lot of videos, and as you can see, I've listened to about a dozen of them. They're all Thank good, you. All funny, all on point. You say a lot of agreeable stuff. And if you don't mind, I know you've shared a bit with me about led you to doing this, but why don't you tell the audience what led to you being a content creator?
Well, I'd say I didn't really want to do any political stuff at first, but for years playing games, I would go on Discord or Ventrilo or TeamSpeak. That shows age.
Yeah, and, same.
Yeah, and I would have people just say, oh my God, who spoke? That'd be me. And then I would get random people just saying, you should do broadcasting. You sound like you should do radios or documentaries or whatever. So, and before, if I heard that, I would just dismiss it as people knowing me and they were being nice. But when it was random strangers doing it repeatedly, my head went, okay, this is not just nice people. These people have known me for all of 10 seconds saying this. So they have nothing to gain by saying this. So that was kind of a thing of maybe there is something to this.
Okay.
And as far as what I wanted to talk about, politics was the main thing that I was following all the time. So it seemed like a never-ending update of information came through politics.
Yeah.
And I don't have any social media presence because I've been banned from all of them. Because I say things that annoy people. And my my language is, how should we say, colorful, to say the least. So the only place I had was Sargon's podcast. And I went, I kind of want to see what would happen if I do a comment and a bunch of comments. And then after a while, my comments became popular. And when I stopped doing them, people were asking me, Spoon, why are you not doing comments? Like, I'm not doing comments anymore. I'm like, why? They're all crap. Do ones. And I went, okay. And even Vicky, who runs she moderates the freaking chat, even she was saying, yes, I can't put your YouTube stuff on. It's too long. So, okay, there's clearly an audience for this. So and Sargon and Callum, who run the show, just went like, he's got a YouTube channel. And I thought, I don't, but now that I've been told to do one, like, okay, this is as good as any as a reason to do it. And then I started promoting it. It's been a little over a month, and I got like 520 subscribers, something like that now, I think.
Yeah, you're doing good. You're halfway to the 1,000 mark that you need to actually make community posts and monetize and stuff. So you're doing pretty good. The thing I wanted to ask you about content creation is you clearly came to this through the organic way that you just said. Now, I say that there's two different kinds of content creators. There are people that want to talk, and so they make a YouTube channel, whether they want to just make money or they just want to be social or whatever. And then there's the transverse of that. There's people have something to say, and that leads them to making a channel. And I feel like you and I are of that second type. I feel like we have things that we want to say and share about what's going on, and that sort of led us to being content creators, even though we may not have chosen it to begin with.
Yeah, I would say I'm probably in that category. For me, it was just a case of I kind of just wanted to say things because the main thing for me is growing up, wittiness was never a strong point of mine. Neither was writing. Mm-hmm. So when a bunch of people tell me now they like the writing, they like how I speak, and I exude confidence, in my head I'm going, this was never me growing up as a kid in any point. And if anyone said to me, you would do YouTube videos where people like you for how you sound and what you say, I would think, what mm-hmm. crack are you smoking? Because that's not me. That's never been me. And it kind of hit me whenever I was with my friends growing up, I was never the funny one or the witty one or the intelligent one. I was just kind of there. So it made me realize that, no, once you are a solo act and you're just doing it and you're releasing it into the ether of the internet, the audience chooses itself. And it's not, you know, you're not limited by who your friends are. There's an audience now that gravitates towards you. So that's a bit of a inverse from the sort of friendship dynamic, and that's a bit new for me to learn that, yeah, you may not think this, but other people do, and they will agree with you, and if you say it, many of them will listen to you. So that made me go, okay, I still have to get used to that, because that's not normally been in my brain in any capacity as far as why mm-hmm. I would not or would speak. So I had to get a bit used to that, and now that there is an audience of people that like me saying funny shit, I go like, oh, look, I can write funny crap and swear and people find that amusing, which gives me great joy because I tend to be quite wiry and aggressive when I talk about politics, especially when it's left-leaning stuff, because it's cancer and stupid, and stupidity mm-hmm. irks the holy crap out of me. And I've had comments saying, angry spoon is best spoon. Oh, my God, I can get people happy by being angry. That's awesome. That's fantastic. I love that.
Yeah, it works well for people. It works well for people that move into content creation. Well, at least in the right, so to speak. I don't really ascribe to the left-right paradigm anymore, but it is sort of how people group themselves. And when it comes to left tube and right tube, it definitely seems like if you're of the political persuasion, people that like that kind of content definitely enjoy the angry fire from time to time.
It's, yeah, because I feel like the angry fire on the right is is more suited to the right, because the right is small government and government sucks, and there's an ample amount of evidence for them to take
and
slingshots.
And also, we're the ones that are
day.
Justified in the righteous anger, because we're the ones that don't want what's happening to be happening.
Yes,
we're the ones that don't want, you know, mass migration and children drag queen story hour and that kind of
yes.
shit.
Yes, and when all the shit kicks in, the right can just say, we've been telling you about this for years, you morons, you weren't listening. Now you're going to face our rage.
Yeah.
Because we've been saying this for ages now and you wouldn't listen. And whereas with the left has this adorably amusing way of trying to redress communism, because that is what they are, in a way that makes anyone that has an ounce of common sense go, you're an historically illiterate moron and you don't know what the hell you're talking about. Because your ideas sound exactly the same as the old intellectuals in the days of yore, and theirs blew up in their face. And clearly you're holding the same package, you've just addressed it, but it's going to blow up in your face as well. Just give it time.
Reminds me of this meme. This is basically us every day now.
Yep, yeah, that sounds about right.
Yeah.
The world's on fire.
Well, speaking of I told you this would happen, are there any particular prophetic comments or videos or just takes that you had on things that you were very proud about prophesying about things that have happened in the last year or two that you'd like to share? Because most of us have those.
Oh, yeah, the coronavirus thing. I knew that from the get-go. That was a bunch of shit.
Yeah, me too.
I just, the first time I saw a bunch of videos coming out of China and people were like flopping down like fish, I went, okay, I don't believe for one second that isn't filtered through the Western media for obvious reasons. And two, I don't know how the hell a respiratory illness makes you do that. That just looks ridiculous, frankly. And then when the mask thing came in, I went, that's going to be permanent.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's going to be no pushback to this, and morons don't understand government. Government, if they're not held to account and there is pushback, they will keep pushing, because that's how any person learns. If there's no pushback to horrible behavior, they will keep doing it. So all the people who said, oh, look, if we just do this now, all of this will end. My head went, no, it's going to get worse, because you fucking morons are obeying government, and government obedience results in tyranny always.
Also, government. One thing about government obedience, not just does it always end in tyranny, but it ends in a loosening of the social fabric where it lets other worse things in, and I think that we've seen that for the last 60 or 80 years since the Brother War era. Like, look at all the rampant pornography and dysgenic communities and terrible parenting and absent fathers. Like, it's basically let in Marxism. And now I know that many people are like, well, yes, it was Marxism all along. It's turtles all the way down. I get that. I get what you're saying. But the willingness all the way back then for people to just go along with the war machine and do what they were told and go kill each other for the state, I think that that's pretty indicative of what we're seeing now. But instead of marching us off to war, they're marching us into the lab to take the injection and making our kids wear masks and telling us that we're bigots if we say no. And I think it's kind of the same song but a different dance, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, it's still a controlling factor. Ultimately.
And also, it's going to thin out our population, which, you know, arguably is what the Brother Wars were about as well.
Yeah, that to me is one of the amusing things about the vaccine, is if it were to go tits up and all the people that have taken it end up snuffing it, which at this point in time looks increasingly likely, because I've heard from people who have in the medical profession, they're saying like a lot of our people who are sick in hospital, almost all of them, they've had the vaccine and they're deathly sick. So mm-hmm. this idea that the COVID vaccine will prevent you from getting sick, in my head, I'm like, no, that's a bunch of crap.
Yeah, there was this.
And
there's
I
this
don't believe that snippet, for a second.
There was this snippet that came out in Australia of this guy saying, of the 200 and some cases, there were 141 hospitalizations, and all but one of them, 93%, were double vaxxed, and the other one was only single vaxxed. And that went viral, and then like a day later, there was a revision, and he was like, oh no, I meant that they were all not vaxxed. And we were all like, yeah, sure, liar. We knew what you meant. You said it with complete confidence. And so he tried to walk it back and act like, oh no, all of the hospitalizations were from people that weren't vaxxed. And nobody fucking believed him, because obviously he was lying through his fucking teeth.
Yeah, I feel like if you did that report and then you read it and you changed it within 5 minutes without anyone reacting to it first, that's maybe plausible. But when you wait a day and you see a massive cavalcade of shit show that you've created, you can't walk it back now. It's too late.
Yeah,
that's pretty much how most things work. If only you could do that with the current U.S. election. Because, man, the thing with Joe Biden is just, I have, there's a lot of things I want to say, but they're all either for a video later or not exactly family friendly.
Save those. I tell you what, save those for... save those for your channel. Speaking of the big direction, which we have to say on YouTube because we can't call it what it actually was, we have to dance around it. So the big erection for the ear at the door. I was thankfully and graciously a content creator from Ingerland named Uzulu brought me on for a couple of months between November and January, since I was an American patriot, not and a nationalist and all that stuff over here. He brought me on to talk about all of the big direction news. And we covered all of that stuff that was at Mike Lindell's big cyber symposium last week or the week before. And we covered all that as it was unfolding for a couple of months. And I don't know. Do you know who Uzulu is? Do you follow him at all?
No, but I do know who Mike Lindell is.
Uzulu is a British guy who is a... classic English liberal. He's of the Sargon cluster, the liberalist cluster. And he has an excellent online... I'm sorry, go ahead. What?
They're conservatives.
Well, basically. I tease Uzulu all the time by calling him a moralist and telling him that, oh, you're more conservative than you know, that kind of thing. He's a good guy. And he has one of the most well articulated and executed channels on a technical level. He is a... I don't want to put words in his mouth, but he's excellent at all of the engineering autism that you need to do to make the coding work. He runs his own stuff. He makes his own programs and bots and things to make his stream look real spiffy and snazzy. He's got an excellent community, and it's called The Cabal. And I think you would enjoy The Cabal, since you enjoy the Lotus Eaters crew. I put the link in the chat for anybody that wants to check out Uzulu's community. It's called The Cabal. Cabal Prevails. And I personally I invite you to come check it out as well. His Discord recently got nuked, so the Discord link now reroutes to the backup Gilded server. And that's where you can find us all now and where you can find Uzulu streams. Definitely come hang out with us and check it out. But speaking of things to go and check out, you are also a good writer, and you have a Substack. And I wanted to share that today as well. This is Spoon's Substack. I just pulled it up on screen here for the stream. Let's scroll down here for a second. You have several things on here, actually.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I stopped doing that because I did the script writing for the videos. So I could probably just post what I write for scripts on that.
Well, I read through a couple of them, and I liked this one. I thought this one was good because, you know, I am of the white, let's say the white specialist.
I knew you were going to pick that one.
And, I'm not going to ask you to read through this in your voice or anything, but as you can see, it's about six or seven paragraphs long. But this is one that I really liked, so I wanted to put it in the chat for everyone. If you want an example of his writing prowess, I highly recommend you start with this one. This is my favorite one of his, as you might have guessed if you know me. But it's quite good, and we're going to go ahead and close that up now.
Yeah. There is one bit of that I'm very, very proud of.
Oh, would you like me to pop it back open and you read it?
No. It's just the bit about for all of the white saviorism attitude that leftists have. I've said to them before, because I don't know how I thought about this, but I thought I would like someone to answer this question, because this is the smartest question I've ever heard, and it is my own question, so that's a bit of ego. But just
you might have a bit of a biased opinion there.
Yeah, ever so slightly. But just the case of they have this attitude of, oh, all of Western civilization is shit and it is so terrible. And in my head, I'm thinking, first of all, your progressive ideology comes from a fucking German guy. Mm-hmm. So that's European in nature as well, you morons. Secondly...
And also, if they hate it, they could just leave.
Yes, that's the other one as well. But the bit that pissed me off is that if you think that all of your ideas, all of Western civilization is so shit and horrible, how in the hell do you think you are qualified to tell all minorities that you will come to their rescue? Based on what?
Right. Like, if they believe that the West is crap and evil, then they're clearly a part of it. So why would they think that they need to go help minorities?
Yes, with the same ideologies that they think are shit. It doesn't make any sense to me. It's the same thing like with the science. They say, like, oh, we trust the science. Bitch, the science that you trust comes from Europe, which you claim is shit. How do you spin this? Their worldview is so contradictory and makes so little sense. I'm amazed it has any traction when even I can just poke a hole in it. Because it's like styrofoam, for heaven's sakes. You can just poke a hole and just right through.
Yeah.
Like, their worldview is not complicated. It's really easy to crumble, effortlessly so.
Yeah, and another easy ontological disproof that you could give to them is, okay, well, if you believe in freedom and you believe in association and liberalism and all these other half-truths and lies that these progressive morons believe in, if you think that's true, then how come all of these droves of non-white people from all around the world will literally, in some cases, sell their own children or mother to get here? If we're that evil and bad, why are these poor minorities that they say the West is screwing over, why are they all in a death race to get here?
Yeah, that's pretty much the case with all white countries in the entire world, because everyone just says, because I've said this before, like, have you ever just looked at white countries? We have more diversity in white countries than any other countries on Earth.
Yes.
So if we're so horribly racist, why are we more diverse? Like, Japanese,
and also,
or Japan,
if we were
full
so
of Japanese.
Horrible to the non-whites, why are they beating down the door and sneaking in just to get here?
Yes.
It's crazy.
No one wants to say this, but I've had some conversations with people who are non-white, and they all tell me white people are too nice.
Yeah, that's what I've
heard. You know, it's bad when a bunch of minorities tell you that white people are too nice.
Mm-hmm.
And that worries me, because I know what happens when white people are not nice.
Oh, yes.
Historically speaking, really bad things happen, especially to other white people.
I recall Rudyard Kipling's "When the Saxon Begins to Hate."
Oh God, yeah, pissed off Saxons.
Somebody messaged me and told me that it wasn't originally Saxon; it was a different word, and that was changed later. Do you know if that's true or not? I don't. Somebody messaged me that, but I'd always heard that it was that when the Saxon began to hate, but they said it was something else, and I didn't look it up to confirm it because I didn't have time and I forgot until just now.
Yeah, it might have been. I'm not terribly familiar with the Saxon history, but I just know if
that was Rudyard Kipling, wasn't it? I think it was Rudyard.
If history is anything to go by, the English tend to be very conquering when they want to be.
Yeah.
For a tiny island, it goes to show you the idea that you need many to conquer. No, you don't. England is a tiny country, and it conquered most of the freaking globe.
Yeah.
So be very careful of a small minority who are vocal and violent. Because they will get their way, because the vast majority of people just don't want anything to do with it. They'll fold.
As
evidence with the Taliban.
I was about to say that. Thank you.
We have four
you
as many
cut me,
troops.
You hit me off at the pass there. Good job. We have hit the 30-minute mark, and now it's where we look for community engagement. So I'm going to go refresh the donation sites. We're going to see what we have from the community. Surely somebody will have something to tell you, because you are an entertaining, fun guest. So let's see. We have at least one thing over on Entropy, and now let's refresh Cash App and the rest. Okay. Well, PayPal's being a cunt and not logging in, so we're going to move to something else. Cash App, nothing new on Cash App. Subscribe Star, nothing new on Subscribe Star. And nothing new over on PayPal. So that means Entropy it is. Over on Entropy, we have my buddy Carnal. Hi, Carnal. Hope you're doing all okay today. Love and prayers to you and your lovely big family. Carnal says, it's a bait and switch tactic for the traitors to divide and conquer Western society. I don't know if it's technically a bait and switch, but I do believe that mass migration and this melting pot lie is to conquer Western civilization. I do believe that. And I think that the progressive anti-white rhetoric around diversity and inclusion, I do think that is on purpose to divide. And you can even look at the origin of how the term racism was introduced into the Western zeitgeist. And it was from, I know you're going to be surprised, some Bolshevist cunts in the teens. And I believe the target was Slavs and someone else where that got introduced in Eastern Europe. But that's even the core of where the concept racism comes from in our modern English parlance. It comes from a bunch of bloody commies that wanted to use it to sow division and destroy.
Yeah, it sounds about right. Pretty much, if it comes from the Soviet Union, that's an indication of we don't touch this because it's cancer. and tends to spiral out of control because Bolshevik history is not exactly family friendly.
No,
unless you qualify the state as a good family.
Well, I mean, they hated the family, and they, you know, wanted people to fuck kids and all this other horrible shit. Like they are anti-family.
Yeah, that's pretty much what they're doing now with Black Lives Matter. Black Lives Matter is also anti-family.
Mm-hmm.
Except for the people who run Black Lives Matter.
The BLM fist is the communist fist. It's the same thing.
Yeah, which is really, really funny to see people actually like hold up their fist and kneel down. I'm like, you bunch of peasant bitches. You're kneeling down for a $4 million Marxist. Well done.
Yeah, moron. I mean, well, we all know socialists love nothing better than to be rich and take everybody's money. So, that is all of the... Oh, no, we have somebody else just popped in. Oh, it's Carnal again. Carnal popped in again with, I put it that way because there are examples of this in the Book of Mormon. Explicit examples, the exact same phenomenon. I'm not familiar with the Book of Mormon, but if you'd like, the next time you're on stream, you can share some Mormon parables and stories with us. I'd love that if you want to come back on and give us some, I don't know, some modern-day wisdom through the lens of the Book of Mormon. I've never had anybody do that with me. So you're welcome to come on and talk about that with us if you like.
Yes.
But that is the end of the community engagement right now. I'm not seeing any others. So.
And use it to explain why Mitt Romney is an asshole.
I bet that most hashtag real Mormons are not don't have kind things to say about shit Romney.
I would venture to guess to think that he and Gavin Newsom is the same person because I've never seen them in the same room together and they look really alike. I just thought about that now. They do sort of look alike, don't they? Yeah, because I just thought about that just now and I went, one looks like the other 20 years older.
Yeah, Carl.
And their policies are roughly the same.
Carl put it in the chat, hashtag fuck Mitt. Yeah, I'm sure that they don't care for him. Yeah, I don't think anybody but establishment bootlickers or establishment shills that stand to get rich off the machine like Mitt Romney. I've never heard any normal person say they like Mitt Romney. Everyone hates that man.
Yeah, because he's an empty suit.
Yeah, he's a stooge like anybody else. Like he's politician cunts.
He looks like the kind of guy they would play like a discount version of Michael Douglas in Wall Street.
Yeah. I see it.
He doesn't have the personality of Michael Douglas or the warmth, but he's got the same kind of backstabbing attitude.
Yeah, definitely. I haven't seen that in ages.
That's a good movie.
It's probably been 20 years since I've seen that.
That's a good movie, though.
So, speaking of good movies, do you plan on doing any kind of... content or stream visitation with people like Mahler or Proper Horror Show or anybody that's in the sort of nebulous right cluster that does any type of cultural commentary that's not political commentary? Do you have anything lined up to work with people like that?
I've never reached out to them and asked.
Okay. I'm not trying to force you into it. I know that lots of young content creators like to do stream spots to get their sub counts up. I didn't know if you had anything in the works.
Yeah, no, as far as Mahler is concerned, I feel he and I would do a very unusual stream because he and I sound quite alike.
Yeah.
And it would be very confusing for people, like, why does Mahler have a brother and why do they sound really similar? Because the first time I was on a stream, someone said, is that Mahler? And someone in the chat said, like, this guy sounds like Mahler.
Well, I think there are similarities, but I mean, maybe it's just because I have a good ear for accents, but you two are definitely distinct to me. I can see how people would think they're similar.
He does have a certain cadence of speaking, but he would be a person that I'd like to have a conversation with. The other one would be Critical Drinker.
I'm not familiar with Critical Drinker. I know the name. I know that person.
Critical Drinker is the shit. I think he is the best movie commentator on YouTube.
Morgoth is my favorite, but I have a lot of strong sympathies with Morgoth and for obvious reasons. But I like Morgoth a lot. I had a Welsh. She's Welsh. I had a Welsh content creator on called Proper Horror Show. Her name's Chloe about a month ago, and I've been enjoying her horror streams. And in a couple of weeks, I'm actually going to be on her stream to talk about the Hellraiser franchise. So I'll let you guys know when I have a specific date for that. I'll be over on her Tuesday double horror feature. And since I'm talking about her, let me pull up her channel and shill for her. She's got a small channel. It's only a little bit bigger than yours. But I really like what she does over there. And she's got a fun crew, and I really like her. And I brought her on for a fun discussion about horror movies and horror genre itself.
So I will say I did vaguely pinch my channel ending from Critical Drinker.
Oh, okay.
Because at the end he just says that that's all I've got for today. Go away now.
Oh, okay.
Because he said he hated that the shilling from people, and then that just was. Like the antithesis of that was just to say go away, and I thought I like that.
It's but like good.
The way, yeah, and I just thought I like the way that he'd be. That's all I've got for today. Then a pause, and then he says something, and I think I just naturally gravitated towards that because Styx also has the same thing. Styx also just says that's about all, and I also had the same thing. It's and that's all it. For today.
Yep.
Yeah,
I like your outro, and that's one of the things I like about Academic Agent, and everybody who follows me knows that I really like Academic Agent and his cluster, and I like how he always ends with, now get out. It's fun, it makes me laugh. So speaking of making people laugh, I can tell that you have well-cultured comedic wit, and I developed mine because one of the things I grew up with is I have some East European immigrant family. And we watched the BBC and various in English shows from Europe when I was a little kid. And I grew up watching things like Fawlty Towers, Flying Circus, The Young Ones, that kind of thing. Did you have any strong comedic underpinning in your childhood development that you think contributed to you having a good comedic wit?
Not in the early years, no. I think later on. If someone were to ask me as far as delivery or how I do punchlines, I think the biggest influence is probably Bill Burr.
Oh, Bill Burr's hilarious. I like
Yes, because he has this kind of rage just thing of where he just points out common sense and then just runs it home.
And then just rants on it and drives it in. Yeah, he's good.
Yes, that would probably be my biggest influence. Louis C.K. is up there as well.
Yeah, he's really clever, too. He's good. I've not listened to much of him, but the little I've heard of him, he does sound brilliant. One of my favorite comedians of all time is Norm Macdonald. I really love Norm, and he's still
Norm is the content. Shit.
Yeah, he's probably, I would say for, now I know that politically we might butt heads, but I also think another comedic great is Dave Chappelle. I think Dave Chappelle's comedy structuring, his takes on things, especially back in the 90s, I thought he was absolutely amazing. Now, I don't know much about his current content, but I did watch two of the specials he put up on Netflix
really good.
In the last 5 years, and I thought they were still stellar, but
yeah.
I don't know his political views, so maybe people will crucify me for liking Dave Chappelle. I don't really know anything about him as a man, so I don't know what his political shit is, but I do think his comedy is pretty great.
He had a really funny moment where he did an SNL thing with Trump, and I wish everyone would watch it because as funny as it is, there is also an element of truth that most people wouldn't expect to hear from I'd say left-leaning comedian, or a Hollywood figure at this point, where he said when Obama was in office, and that's when Dave Chappelle's show took off, and he got money, and the first thing that Obama
Dave Chappelle's show took off a lot earlier than that in America.
No, but with him getting money. Was during the Obama
you mean
years.
The Netflix shows, or
no. He said that during when he got wealth, so to speak, and Obama came into office.
Oh, okay.
Roughly coinciding at the same time.
Contentious there. It's just his show was a lot earlier than Obama.
No, but this is was what he said in his joke.
Oh,
and
okay.
He said he just said use the N word and just say I just got this money. When Obama got in office, and when Trump and his friend said, "Are you going to leave America now that Trump's in office?" And he just went, "Nope, I'm going to stay here and get that tax break." In my head, I'm going, does that not tell you celebrities that, or everyone about you celebrities, they don't care about politics? Their wallet is their main concern, and their wallet says Trump is great for it, so they're not going to fucking move. That is the reason why all of those celebrities, none of them fucked off to Canada like they were screaming like autists to the heavens. Did any of them budge or move? No, they stayed their asses right the fuck where they are because Trump was good for business.
I think if you take everything else off the table and just look at economics and domestic policy is in regards to economic growth, Trump is probably the greatest president we've ever had.
At least for many people in this lifetime.
Now, I know that there's a lot more to it when it comes to economic impact and stuff that is a lot bigger in scope than a single term of a president. But if you're going to pin onto a president the economic things that happen because of policies that he endorses during his presidency, and you only look at the economics, Trump's probably the best we've ever had, right?
Yeah, like, Trump is glowing, roaring president.
Yeah, I mean, it's, and which is sad, but that there's all this other bullshit, because I don't know about you, but I would rather not have to talk about race. I would rather just be rich and enjoy an awesome kick-ass community, but here we are. We don't make the rules. We don't make the rules, sadly.
Yeah, but the race game is a freaking grift to make money and provide politics with a reason to exist.
Which is, well, here I am. I exist because people talk about race and there's race grifters. Like, I'm not a grifter, but I just got tired of people that are in my country, a white country, being crucified and shamed around every corner just because we happen to be European descent. I got tired of that shit, and so I started talking about it, and here I am today with the channel. So
I would get very, very rude if someone just says anything about whiteness. I would just say, I am terribly sorry that your ancestors sucked and mine kicked the shit out of them. It's not my fault. It's not my fault.
Your ancestors like whiteness. I think whiteness itself is an anti-white term, because what they do is...
It also makes no sense.
Yeah, exactly. Like, what is whiteness? Like, that doesn't make any sense.
I just find it very bizarre, because if I look at a... This idea of like a white hegemony and that all white people get along. I look at those people and go, you do realize Europeans were kicking the shit out of each other in the former half of the last century in two world wars. What the fucking hell makes you think they would get along just because they're white, you dumbass? They don't even speak the same language.
Yes, it's not just it's not just the erasure of our ethnicities, but when I have to make arguments to people, especially disaffected liberals and people just, you know, coming to the awareness of what's going on, they'll say, oh, but I mean, a lot of people, especially in my personal life, they'll be like, especially at church or people who haven't really been paying attention till now, they're still stuck in the mindset of, well, it doesn't matter what color skin you are, we're all Americans. And I'm like, okay, well, the establishment, the military, the media, these jackals in education, all of this anti-white regime, they don't hate us for being American or Finnish or French or Swiss. They hate us for being our race, not our ethnicity. They hate us for being white. We can never change being European, just like someone who grows up, like you said, you're a South African man. That's who you are. And I'm an American and I'm white. South Africa, American, French, Scottish, Swedish, whatever, those are white ethnicities. So they are the term whiteness. It basically creates a new evil person ethnicity that they lump us all into. That's why I hate the term whiteness.
Yeah, but that's all political persuasions. They need something to hate to drive the machine.
Yeah.
Sadly. And there's a bit of me that just thinks like that's to get rid of minorities.
I do think that the globalist agenda, or whatever you want to call the NWO, I don't think that they just want to annihilate whites. I think that quote-unquote white civilization, that is the primary speed bump, the hurdle that they have to overcome. But I do believe the goal is the annihilation of all racial and ethnic bonds across the world. Because if everyone is a disenfranchised, nationless, godless
nomad,
individual,
essentially,
then everyone is just an integer that will forever be a wage slave in the globalist machine. Because if there's no unity and nobody has anything to care about besides material wealth and gain, then nobody has anything that will be strong enough to unify against this power. And I do think that's the end goal, is the erasure of all race and ethnicities.
Yeah, that's the whole goal of open borders.
Yeah.
Is to destroy the nation state.
Yeah.
Which I found really, really funny, because everyone just says like, oh, look, the thing of calling people Nazis, I find that very bizarre and frankly infuriating. Because what is a Nazi in today's world want? So they want voting rights and the rights to be armed and a nation state.
Mm-hmm.
And they're very isolationist for the most part, whereas the Nazis were conquering the shit out of everything they could find. As soon as Hitler came to power, there was not exactly an armed population, and Hitler was a dictator. There's no voting. So how in the fuck do you relate them to Nazis? Who the hell knows?
Yeah.
It's just a dirty word, but it just pisses me off, because there's no relation to Nazis in any way, shape, or form. It's just
it's
weird.
That's why I say that Hitler, in the anti-white narrative, Hitler is the great Satan and Nazis are the demons. And that's why they label us all that, is because in that narrative, oh, the boogie mustache man, he is the great Satan. He is the super evil. And that's why they liken us all to the Nazis and Hitler and all of that, because
if you say mustache man, I think Stalin.
Yeah, well, yeah. I mean, back then, I guess everybody was a mustache man, but you know what I mean.
Except for Churchill, he rocked the top hat.
He sure did.
As do I.
That's cool. Are you a top hat guy in real life, or just your avatar?
No, I think my avatar would. I don't think it's very bizarre because I tend to lean in with the fancy pants accent and the aesthetic of you know, cliched snooty like 1800s rich guy. But in real life, I wear hoodies and a baseball cap on my head. So
oh, cool. Okay.
Yeah. So the aesthetic is not exactly matching the avatar. But I've been on streams before with my face, so it's difficult to find them now because I think the streams that I went on were probably deleted by now. So I don't think you'd find me unless you were more obscure corners of YouTube.
Go ahead.
No, that's all I wanted to say there.
Speaking of corners of YouTube, I know that you are familiar with Carl Benjamin, of course, and yes, the Liberalists and Lotus Eaters and all that. Are there other influential or even friends personally that you have that are content creators in our connected clusters that you'd like to talk about or that heavily influenced you?
Rotten Politics. He's been very cool to me. He's the one that like shares up all my stuff.
Rotten Politics. I don't know that person. Let me look them up.
Yeah, Rotten Politics. He does like really short segments like I do, where okay, he just like straight up just gives the facts and lay it in. And I think he's from Liverpool. God help me if he's not, he's going to rip me in for fucking saying that. I liked his stuff because he's got the accent that can make shit funny just by saying it.
We Got a Problem guy. He's hilarious too.
Yeah. He's also, I've spoken to him as well. He was very nice. Cool. I've spoken to a fair few people actually. I spoke to Dev. I've spoken to Aiden. Aiden was actually the nicest out of the bunch.
Yeah, she's a sweetheart. She's been on my channel a few times, and I've talked to her on other streams. She's a fun person.
Yeah, Rotten is very nice as well. I'm trying to think of anyone else. V as well.
Yeah, I love V. I've been a V fan for like 5 years. I knew him back when he had very few following.
I think he was probably my favorite YouTuber because I watched Sargon, and then V came on, and I went, "Who is this guy with this voice, because he is hilarious. He can just say the most insane shit with that accent, and it's funny." Because normally high-pitched voices would annoy me, but his just makes me laugh.
V sounds like my East European grandmother, and I love it. It's great.
Yeah, he's. I think he is. He deserves way more subs than he has.
I don't think he wants more subs than he has, because if he gets any bigger, he'll probably get censored all to shit. He's actually said that a lot on his streams.
Do you know who's was also a very underrated YouTuber? And I'd say as far as rhetoric goes, who was my closest, is a guy called Louis Levi.
I like Louis. Yeah, I like him.
Yes, he is probably my closest person, I would say, as far as similar content goes. Like, he also just goes into, like, rage fits.
Yes, and one of his recent videos about the absolute hypocrisy over America and Israel is one of the best videos I've heard about why and how it sucks trying to talk about Jews and Israel in America because of like the ADL. You've got all these different misconceptions and lies around what Israel is, what Zionism is, and it ends up in just being this horrible clusterfuck in America where even our own government is Israel first over America. So let me share that link because it's one of the best Louis Levi videos that I have ever done. That
I would
ever
say
heard.
If there is anyone on YouTube I would like to do a stream with, Louis would be my first choice, hands down.
Yeah, he's pretty good. He's pretty good.
Easily, just because I feel he has the he has no filter, and he just says this is the fucking problem, and he's got a very blunt way of looking at the world, like especially like when it comes to like the police and race relations. Like, he just says like, this is the fucking problem, these people are not like you, and you cannot treat them with kid gloves. These are people that are just psychotic, and you need, like, he's very into a he's got a very pro morality of physical force, that it is a moral necessity in a civilized society. And it's something that our society very frowns upon, and Louis is just, no, fuck off, you need this. And I very, very much agree, especially because where I'm from, this idea that you can't have law and, or you can have no law and order and the country will be stable. No, what fucking world do you live in? That's not real. And if you try that shit, it's just bizarre. Like, hey, look, let's just defund the police. If I was a criminal and there's less police around, is that going to help crime? or is it going to stop it? No, it's going to help it, you fucking idiot.
Yeah. That, and again, I think that a big part of the acceleration of in the UK, AOC. They call it in the UK, they call it BAME. In America, they call it POC. I think the reason that we've seen an acceleration in the UK, they've had a complete dysgenic breakdown of law enforcement in most major cities, especially.
Oh my God! Yes, it is.
And
a
then
fucking joke.
And then over here, we've had it, and even culminated last year in an actual defund the police movement, which, you know, I wasn't surprised when it happened. It was just, hey, wow, mask off again, Jesus. But I think one of the reasons that we've seen the influx and the uplifting of non-white people in white countries paired with the anti-white rhetoric is because the people behind this, they want our societies to disintegrate. And they know exactly how to do it. Is you bring in a bunch of people or take people that are already here, put them in a box, shake them up and make them angry, and then tell them it's all the regular white people's fault and then watch society collapse. Like, that's the formula, and they're really good at it. They've been doing it for 50 years.
Well, yeah, probably longer than that. It's stupid.
Just, I don't know. I don't know enough about history to say exactly when it started, but definitely since I've been around. So,
with the what, the sort of progressive movement, late 1800s.
Oh, for sure. I mean, I'm sure it goes back farther than that, but I know that at least in America, it's been
America's
going
original
on since,
progressive era was about the 1800s. I had to do
for
a
sure.
video on it, so
for sure. I don't have a link on hand, but one of the recent videos that Radlib did. Was talking about how progressives and Marxists and big state globalist types were actually the ones who instigated and then, quote unquote, won what the narrative calls the American Civil War, which I do not call it that. I call it either the War of Northern Aggression or the War Between the States, because it was not a civil war. It was a secession war. It was not a civil war. But anyway, it was a very interesting video showing that it was actually globalist progressive Marxists that instigated and then, quote unquote, won that war back in the mid-1800s in America, which I found that very interesting. I didn't know what roots that there were to progressive globalism going all the way back to that point in America. I thought it was very, very eye-opening.
Yeah, Moldbook has a similar take.
If I could read, I would read more of that, but I have to get my books through audio format, so I listen to a lot of Skeptical Waves. Speaking of Skeptical Waves, that's right. Yiz is going to shill somebody else. Do you know Skeptical Waves? I know I mentioned him in our Discord chat the other day. Hello?
I have to peek outside of my booth.
Okay.
It's across from me.
Can barely read the text, is too small.
All right. The channel I just shared is Skeptical Waves, and he has a text-to-speech program, and he puts up...
Oh, yeah, you told me about this.
Mm-hmm, yeah, he puts up a lot of content, and I can't listen to it all because it's so many hours of content, but when I'm working or just driving or having a walk or an exercise, I like to put on books by dissidents and old authors that talk about the decay of civilization and the different problems that we're facing and all the good dissident mind fuel. I like to listen to his channel because I have real trouble reading books. I have untreated ADHD. I don't like the medicine for it. It makes me feel numb and bad. So I don't take it. So that, unfortunately, the only thing that I've not been able to overcome with just willpower is the ability to read well. So I get my books through audio form. But regardless,
I tend to just read them aloud.
Yeah, but if I go slow and read a book in a way that I have to do to make my brain retain it, it would take me all day just to read like a chapter of a book. I don't have that kind of time to devote to that. So I get my books through listening.
I tend to just read them and listen to myself, as arrogant as that may sound, because I heard myself in reading. I'm like, I kind of like how I sound. I can listen to myself easily. Because before...
Hey, nothing wrong with that.
No, I think for many people, it's a case of... you'll find this with anyone who does any recording work. There's a tendency for humans to hate how they sound because there is a level of bass that does not exist outside of your own ear. So when you hear your own voice, this is not how you actually sound. So when you hear it on recording, you think, I don't sound like that to me, I guess, but this is how you sound to everyone else.
Yeah.
So so when I began to learn some editing techniques about how to make the voice boomy, and I heard my voice when it's properly processed, I went, oh my God, this is what I sound like. I sound great. I have no problem with doing this editing work. This is fine.
Yeah, you do have a great voice. We're getting up to the hour mark right now. And remember, Corner Club segments only go between 60 and 90 minutes. So I'm going to be posting all of the ways that you can financially gift in the chat again. Go ahead and get your financial gifts, paid chats, and entropy question widget questions and comments in for Spoon now, because we will be wrapping up in the next 15 to 20 minutes. So go ahead and get those in. I'm putting the necessary links in the chat right now for you to do so. And last but not least, let's see what we have here. We also have the PayPal link. Now, for those of you that subscribe over on Subscribestar, you can send tips, which are basically like super chats, but they come through the Subscribestar interface. And I read those out live on stream too. They don't happen very often, but for those of you that do subscribe over on Subscribestar, remember you can give super chats that way too if it's easier and better for you. So with that being said, we're getting up to the hour mark where we're going to take our next break and have community engagement. Hopefully we'll have some interesting things from the community for you. So if you guys listening have anything you want to ask Spoon or things you want to tell him, or maybe you've got some topics you want him to cover, send those in and we'll get them read out here. So, but before we get to that though, I wanted to ask you, moving forward here with where you are with your channel, let's say that you get really big. Let's say that you get 10,000 more subscribers in the next month. Have you thought about what you might want to do or who you might want to influence or how? If you stumble into a really big following, do you have any dreams or aspirations for influencing people in certain ways with your content?
Yes, I'd like to rule the world.
Okay. Would you like to elaborate on that?
I would be a great dictator because I do not have the willpower or the insane lust for power. I would be like the least strict dictator ever, because
so you wouldn't be one, basically.
No, I feel like I would like, yes, I am going to rule. Do you know who I would like to be? If you ever play, and this is going to piss some people off, but Mr. House in Fallout New Vegas.
Oh, yeah. I liked New Vegas. I haven't played it in ages, but I remember loving it. It was good.
Yeah, because his mentality is just like, I'm sitting in a tube, and my goal is to make the perfect society, and I'm the best one for the job. And I'm not tempted by, you know, petty wealth squabbles and riches because, well, I'm essentially a corpse talking through a machine. So he's not tempted by outside factors that would sway a normal person.
Yeah, yeah.
And I feel like the world needs more of that as far as people goes. And I know that's a very tall order because humans are not, generally speaking, like that. They're driven by self-interest.
Right.
Irrationally so. Not very Ayn Randian for all people say, oh, that's very Ayn Rand. No, yours is, I want to climb the ladder by stepping on a throne of skulls getting there. No. That's how politicians work. And it doesn't work in the private sector so well.
Well, in a more realistic conversation, then let's not talk about you being the next Mr. House. Is there a particular goal or particular avenue that you would like to have influence being a content creator? Any particular market or niche you'd like to cut out for yourself? Anything like that you've thought of?
No, not really. I just did the videos because I thought they were funny and people listened to them.
I love your content. It's great. You wouldn't be here otherwise.
No, I think the main thing I just wanted to take away is just that politics is not as complicated as people would like to make it believe. It's a lot more simpler than people realize, at least from my perspective. And I think if there is one thing I could drive home to people, it's this. All politicians, human beings in general, they all work horribly under two things. Unaccountable power and an incessant need to advance. And if those two things are allowed to run rampant without any accountability, shit hits the fan. So as far as looking at any politics, I would just tell people, ask yourself who benefits from this. If you see anything that is suspicious or a fuck up or just insanely stupid, there's probably a reason for it. It's not as stupid, it's malevolent.
Right. Yeah, I forget which razor it is, but it's the don't attribute to malice what can be attributed to incompetence. I don't think that works when it comes to global politics and big state politics, because that shit is actively evil, and somewhere there are evil people doing the evil, and they know what's going to happen, or they at least expect what's going to happen. Because when you listen to these fuckers at these UN summit meetings, you listen to the World Economic Forum, you listen to you see reports from what people talk about in the Pentagon or over in London or at the Brussels meetings. These evil assholes, they know what mass migration is going to do. They know what ethnic displacement of whites in white countries is going to do. They want that. They actively seek it, and they pat each other on the back for accomplishing it. So I am done attributing to incompetence. I think that we should start calling all of these cunts evil, and that's what we should rally around, is pointing to all of these scumbags and calling them evil, saying that they're wrong, because I think that's what we should rally behind, is how wicked they are and the wicked things they do to us.
Yeah, though I do think Joe Biden is stupid.
Well, they can also be stupid. You can be stupid and evil.
Yeah, but I definitely think, because I tend to subscribe to the notion that politicians, they're more evil than they are stupid. But with Joe Biden, my head's going like, no, I'm going to make an exception for this motherfucker, because this guy is dumb as a bucket of donkey dicks, to quote Uncle Ruckus.
Oh, God.
Because it's just... I looked at him, and I this is something I want to point out, and I actually want to do a video on this later. I said, there is one silver lining to Joe's incompetence, is that if you look at everything that he's done, not only in the presidential term, but in his entire career as a senator, he has a track record of nothing but failures, which is gloriously carried into his presidential term as well. But there comes a point, and this, I'm not saying this could happen, but this is like the best chance for the normies to wake the fuck up. Is that if you look at Joe and the fact that everything he touches dies, I'm hoping enough of them will be smart to think, why are we following this guy's coronavirus advice when he's wrong about everything, and the chances of him being wrong about this as well is going to be extremely high. So don't listen to him, because the man is a moron. And I'm hoping that that is something that some of them would realize, because everything this man touches is just goes to shit. So...
Well, I think as someone who cares about the well-being of your own people, the well-being of your country, even the well-being of your own community, even if it's small, I don't think that we can ever rely on a silent majority, the ignorant masses waking up, etc. Bell curve people are bell curve people for a reason. They want to be left alone. They don't want to care. They want to have their grill. They want to raise their kids, and that's good. So, we can't build a movement or think that we're going to have an end result that relies on some mass awakening. That's never going to happen. I don't think anybody that believes that is grounded
in reality. I somewhat disagree with that.
Okay, all right. Then explain.
The reason being is because it actually affects them personally. That's the difference.
No, I do think that minormies or silent masses, that's why we're seeing so many angry parents at PTA right now in America. That's why you're seeing so many people protesting this lockdown insanity, is because it has inconvenienced them. It has impacted them. But when it comes to some kind of greater awakening moving towards a goal, I do not think that populist uprisings are a solution to our current predicament. It might only make things worse. That's my stance on this right now. I might change my mind as time goes on, but that's where I see things right now.
No, I agree with that in part, but I think I'm not saying it can happen. I'm saying that there is potential in it, because that is the one thing that affects absolutely everyone. The same thing with the employment figures and the businesses turned down, the gas prices and all of that. That this would be a good domino for them to actually fall, because once they start hitting that one, I'm hoping they will go, well, if he's wrong about this. Because that's generally how people go down a pipeline, is they take the first step, and then once the first domino falls, they will look at everything else, and generally speaking, that's how it goes. I'm not saying it can happen, but I'm saying as far as potential for shit hitting the fan, and now is a good time to take notice. Because if you compare this to Trump, it's like night and fucking day. I said this before, like with the news, you're starting to see that even the Democrats, the machine that is the MSM, is even starting to turn on them. Because they're just saying that, okay, the monster that we've created with propaganda is now setting the world on fire, and we can't whistle happy-go-lucky anymore. It doesn't work.
Yeah.
And now they have to save face by telling the truth, because
Steve Bannon,
affecting people.
Steve Bannon and his populist war room, they talk about that. They talk about that a lot. And I understand why people say that, but I don't know. Perhaps I'm hesitant to want that because I see that as what led us to the brother wars in the beginning. And I'm hesitant that that will turn out as a net good in the end. But that's why I just push general white positivity and general national unity among peoples and to fight the lies. Because I don't necessarily think that getting a whole bunch of bell curve people that barely know anything ready to pick up rifles and start killing people, I don't know if that's going to lead to anything good or not. I'm not sold on that idea.
I wouldn't say they have to become violent, but they have to be, let's say, increase their IQ by at least a standard deviation, so to speak.
Yes,
at least politically speaking, anyway.
Yeah,
I know.
Yeah.
I know this is a very, very tall order, and one can dream.
It's a good thing to dream. I agree. I'll shake hands with you on that.
My dream involves people being smarter. Good luck.
Yeah. I mean, like I said on that stream with Donald and Nullis the other day. I am of the old school scientific progressive mentality. I want us to reach the stars. I want us to build starships and understand, you know, quantum physics and be able to alter stars and travel to different realities and shit. Like that's what I want. So I would love people to be smarter and wiser and rise above all this bullshit that mires us down here. But again, that's
Germany,
a tall order, and it's wish upon a star stuff.
As Germany is getting screwed to pieces by the massive amount of immigration they've taken from Mama Merkel, you can always just you can go Second World War, Nuremberg Trials Part 2, and then just pinch a bunch of German engineers.
Yoink, give me that.
I'm pretty sure they'd be more
welcome. Gives me that IQ. Gives me that IQ.
Yes. Except that you know Nazis running around now. Well, they might have some. Usually called Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Well, with that being said, we're going to move to the final segment of the show, which is doing community engagement one last time and then saying our goodbyes and getting out of here, because we all have weekends to start, myself included. So we're going to check Cash App first and see what we have going on over there as we refresh Subscribestar and their PayPal.
Is fake and gay.
Democracy is fake and gay. Yes, I stand by that.
Can you say that on YouTube?
I say it all the time, I guess. Okay. Fake and gay is kind of a meme phrase. I think you're allowed to say that. Nothing over on PayPal, so we're going to close that down. Over on Subscribestar, no new tips showing up, so we're going to close that down. Thank you to the two of you that were over on Trovo today. Nothing to read out on Trovo. Going to close that down. We're going to open the chest for the eight of you over on DLive. I'm going to add me some lemons to the chest. There's 50 lemons in the chest. That's 58. So everybody pay attention over on DLive. You've got a treasure chest going to open in 30 seconds. Click the thing, get you some free lemons, and then we'll be done over on DLive. And now we're going to move to Entropy. First up, WestY11, a good friend of the channel, buddy of mine, says that the razor I was talking about earlier is Hanlon's razor. That's it. Thank you, Wes. Plus one internet points for Wes today for reminding me that's Hanlon's razor. WestY11 says, oh, I forgot. Yeah, me and Wes even talked about this the other day, and I totally forgot to do it. You need to be invited to the Cabal Refuge server. That's the one that WestY11 runs. For the Cabal people to have a Discord to share things with. Because at the moment, Gilded still can't do a couple of things for community that Discord can. I don't know if I can send him an invite, Wes. Wes, if I can send him an invite, let me know. But I can just give you his Discord ID, and you can add him directly. I think that would probably be better. So let me just go ahead and send you his Discord ID right now. I'm going to send Spoon. I'm going to send him your Discord ID, so he will... and can invite you to the good place. All right, Wes, it's in the pipe. gay pun intended. Now, moving on. Carnal Conservative in the question widget says, whiteness should have been conquered by American. Whiteness should have been conquered by Americans, but we keep letting our enemies deny us that heritage. I don't really know what you mean by that. I don't like the term whiteness. It just sounds ugly. Like, I wouldn't want to ascribe things that different African ethnicities do as blackness. I mean, because there's a lot of difference between a Kenyan and an Ethiopian, just like there's a difference between a Swede and a Canadian. I don't like the term whiteness. I think it's ugly, and I don't like the way it's used.
That's like the worst examples you could pick, because both of the first two do have something in common. They both make amazing endurance runners, and the second one are both socialistic shithole countries.
Tomato, tomato. I don't know how to qualify that anymore. Carnal Conservative again, over on the question widget, says, when it comes to the left, always assume malice.
Yes,
I agree.
Agreed.
I agree. Our enemies are definitely very malicious. So that being said, that is all of the community engagement. And for those of you,
that's a good point someone needs to make, though.
Sure.
Is with the left the malice thing, because all of their ideas have been tried. This is the one thing that I have a problem with people that say, oh, you should read left-leaning news. And in my head, I'm going, no, because I know exactly what they're going to say. Their manual is a fucking century old. Like, there's nothing new coming out of them. I know what they're going to do. They're power-hungry government pro-psychopaths. Like, there's nothing interesting or new that you're going to learn from them. It's just a repackaged version of an older age that has gone to shit. So never, this is going to sound really weird, but don't read left-leaning news sources, because you're not going to learn anything other than the fact that they're stupid and crazy.
Well, I don't like mainstream news sources at all. And that's why I do my best to get my quote-unquote news from content creators, because at least I will know what's important to what's going on. And then I can take those buzzwords and headlines, and then I can go do my own investigation instead of just waking up every day and being like, oh, I need to read MSNBC and Fox News, and I need to do derpa derpa der. Like, I stopped doing that many years ago because it was just bullshit. So now I listen to what the buzz is, and then I go looking into the particulars of what people are talking about, and I get my news in a much more organic way, and I feel like I know better what's going on than if I just listen to news.
Yeah, I tend to go to Real Clear Politics.
And then Real Clear Politics. I know what they are, but I don't use them. About the only news site I frequent regularly is AllSides.com, because it's kind of an aggregator that shows different persuasions of news.
Yeah, that's what the Real Clear Politics is as well.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah.
Well,
they do their own headlines as well, though.
I would like to address a little bit of in the YouTube chat. I know that there are many of you in the YouTube chat that want me and Spoon to engage with things you say, but I say every single stream, I do not like to go digging in the live chat trying to answer questions, because as I go looking for things, it moves and sometimes it disappears earlier in the chat. If there are questions or comments you want me to read aloud and to address with my guests, put them in either a paid chat or a question widget chat on the Entropy interface. The question widget costs you no dollars, no dollary dues. You can come over there and type whatever you want, and I will get to it. So if you want me to address things with my guests, don't just put it in chat and hope that I read it in the YouTube interface, because I won't. I have to train you people to start using Entropy. So go use Entropy. With that being said, we've gone through all of the Entropy, and now we've come to the end of the film. We've come to the end of the stream. So with that being said, is there anything that you would like to shill or talk about, or any projects you have coming up, or even with others, maybe some live events going on over in the British Isles that you would like to shill?
Not at the moment that I can think of off the top of my head. Although okay. I have to do maybe like one or two videos today still, talking about the new something in the Elder one. And I probably will yell, because I read a bit of it that I wanted to do the video on. And I went, oh my God, the incompetence of this man is just so astoundingly stupid that I have to rant about it, because it is a ranty video. But there's fruitful information in it, because if you've noticed about my videos, I tend to leave, I'd like to leave every video with a thought that makes you go like, oh yeah, that's a good point.
Mm-hmm.
Like, quite interesting. Like a QI version of my own videos.
I just put your link into the chat. So we will round out the stream by saying Spoon's content is great. I've been enjoying it for the last couple of weeks. I've only known Spoon for a couple of weeks, but he has a great voice. He was willing to come on Discordant Dragons. He says some really agreeable shit in a very funny, entertaining way. And the best thing is, his content is short, and you don't have to waste 30 minutes to hear 2 minutes of content. He does an excellent job of, he is the surgical strike of comedic news content. So definitely go check him out. He's a fun time. And as always, I will have Discordant Dragons coming this Monday night. And unless I hear otherwise, we're going to have Kenzie Puff from Mac and Liberty on. We're going to have a couple of other people, too, that you guys know and love. Wes Y. Levin's kicking around the chat, and if he wants to come on, he's always welcome. So it'll hopefully be another fun time of humoring and make-believe dragons about Clown World. I hope you all have a wonderful weekend. Keep heart, fight smart, and speak the truth. And we'll see you guys.